Hello everyone, my name is Sarah Baker, and today I will be presenting on A League of Her Own, an exploration and analysis of March for Harmony at Fanfare and Suite Divertimento, both prominent wind band works by Germaine Tailleferre. Before I begin the formal presentation, I have to provide recognition to two individuals who helped this research come about. The first is Paul Wehedge, a saxophonist, conductor, and composer who attended the University of Texas and the Paris Conservatoire. He is currently the director of Music Fabric Publishing Company in France since 1997, and is also the current orchestrator for Tailleferre's music. He currently lives in France and personally knows the Tailleferre family, specifically her granddaughter. And a current project that he is working on is recording all Assis's piano music onto Naxos. He is one of a handful of the most prominent scholars in this department. I've also provided his website for access if you'd like to dive into his research and music more. And the second, a personal friend of mine, is Robert Shapiro, a researcher, historian, and the go-to expert regarding the life and times of the French group Assis. He is the author of the book pictured on the screen titled Assis, the French Composers and Their Mentors Jean Cocteau and Eric Satie. Currently living in Tubac, Arizona, he has access and a collection of many of Assis's original manuscripts in his archive. And the current project that he is working on is a novel of correspondence of George Orrique's life. He has interviewed many of Assis's connections, including Desiree Dandin, a prominent aspect of this research and the life of Germaine Tailleferre, Mio's wife, Mio being one of several of the Assis members, and Tailleferre's family, including Tailleferre herself when she was alive. Germaine Tailleferre, the only female member amongst a group of notorious French composers known as Assis, wrote a substantial catalog of music throughout the 20th century, and her artistry expanded French music and composition for women composers. While her oeuvre includes almost every musical medium, her wind band works are lesser known. Tailleferre lacked opportunities to compose for wind band until her late 70s, perhaps due to a heavily male-dominated medium with original repertoire that did not fully develop until the second half of the 20th century. Within the past 20 years, scholarly research and analysis regarding Tailleferre's works have grown in popularity, but focused primarily on her solo and chamber repertoire. Therefore, the purpose of this presentation is to explore the musical merit and compositional methods present within Tailleferre's original manuscripts and wind band compositions in collaboration with Desiree Dandin, specifically mentioning the March for Harmony at Fanfare and Suite Divertimento. This will also highlight her importance as a member of Assis and contributions to French music and wind band. From an early age, Tailleferre excelled in all musical facets. Her father vehemently rejected Tailleferre's musical aspirations. So with the aid of local nuns escorting Tailleferre to the Paris Conservatoire without her father's knowledge, Tailleferre's mother kept her daughter's musical studies a secret. Eventually, Tailleferre's success illuminated the papers, and upon recognizing her musical genius, Tailleferre's father showed pride regarding her accomplishments, yet offered no financial support. Undeterred, Tailleferre continued to support her own education by teaching private piano lessons. A French music scholar, James Harding, encapsulates Tailleferre's exceptional musical abilities while attending the Paris Conservatoire in the following statement. She carried off first prizes in harmony, counterpoint, and accompaniment. She had more than her just share of gifts. Future Assis members, Darius Mio, Arthur Onager, and George Orrique joined Tailleferre at the Paris Conservatoire, forming the foundation for future Assis collaborations. Prior to the inception of Assis, 19th century France was a cultural epicenter due to several Paris expositions. As a result, French citizens were primarily drawn toward foreign musical influences, leading to the decline of nationally recognized French salon and cabaret music. French musicians and composers grew concerned, prompting musical innovations for nationalistic representation within the arts. In 1871, the Société Nationale de Musique was founded in order to escape the clutches of Germanic influence and promote authentic French music and musicians. Yet, Richard Wagner, a prominent German composer, remained popular in Paris with the premiere of his opera Parsifal in 1872. Two groups emerged as a result, those who supported Wagner and those who opposed him. Musicians opposing Wagner's ideas of German romanticism continually searched for additional modes of musical expression, and their methods significantly varied. A popular choice, led by composers Claude Debussy and Maurice Ravel, included impressionism, encompassing lush textures, extended harmonies, and obscure melodies. Those who desired an alternative outlook strove for heightened clarity. A new approach that avidly encouraged melodic simplicity and clarity was led by revolutionary poet Jean Cocteau, a Renaissance man with limited musical aptitude, and Erik Satie, an up-and-coming composer. Through Cocteau's 77-page manifesto, Le Coq et Arlequin, he expressed unique French musical ideologies, rejecting all foreign influences, which included bombastic Wagnerian romanticism, impressionistic melodic ambiguity, and the French conservatoire's Teutonic emphasis. Seeking a return to simplicity, objectivity, and clarity through short, accessible, and democratizing music relating to everyday life and people became the musical mission. Both Cocteau's manifesto and Satie's compositions ultimately influenced six young composers: Georges Auric, Arthur Honegger, Louis Duret, Darius Milhaud, François Poulenc, and Germaine Tailleferre, forming Les Six. However, Les Six presented a paradox. Though all members agreed French music should be identifiable through middle and lower class art forms, all members were not philosophically or compositionally cohesive. Les Six, in essence, represented a six-pointed star, with each composer facing a different direction, yet branching from a common center. Association within this group provided each member a platform to elevate their own musical aesthetics and maintain their ultimate goal of creating a unique French sound. During her years at the Paris Conservatoire, Tailleferre studied many prominent and historical composers, including Bach, Rameau, Couperin, Mozart, and Scarlatti. Tailleferre often spent time with Milhaud at his flat studying Ravel, Debussy, Schoenberg, and Stravinsky's works as well, much to the conservatoire's disapproval, due to their strong Teutonic emphasis. She admired Milhaud's ongoing exploration of polytonality, which she later utilized in her compositions. After leaving the conservatoire, Tailleferre studied under theorist and musician Charles Kakela until 1923. Kakela often recycled musical material from his previous works into later compositions. Through his influence, Tailleferre utilized self-borrowing techniques within her compositional framework as well. Now, Tailleferre, in contrast to Cocteau's manifesto, appreciated Impressionism. As one of Ravel's unofficial students from 1923 until 1930, Tailleferre gained significant advice regarding orchestration and formal clarity through an Impressionistic lens, incorporating diatonicism, polymodality, modal modulation, and chordal harmonies into many of her works. Though Tailleferre's musical prowess had continually grown with the aid of her mentors, the Second World War completely uprooted her livelihood. After immigrating to the United States in 1942 with her daughter, they were able to return to France in 1946. Upon that return, Tailleferre immediately embarked upon a prolific compositional period. Her musicality manifested through many new genres throughout the 50s and 60s, including film scores, operas, ballets, concertos, radio, television, and theater. In addition, the early 1970s demonstrated Tailleferre's interest in solo and chamber works. A Tailleferre scholar, Colleen White, states, "Tailleferre composed in the neoclassical style well into the 1970s, using predictable forms from the 17th and 18th centuries, including the serenade and the minuet, combined with polytonality and polymodality, brevity, and the use of small ensembles." Tailleferre at this point even created her first and last serialist piece, a three-movement solo clarinet, composition. Now, Tailleferre's compositional innovations, including self-borrowing, extended harmonies, complex counterpoint, and tuneful melodies, are remarkable in light of everything she endured throughout the first half of the 20th century. In addition to numerous personal issues, including two terrible marriages with men who constantly discouraged her livelihood as a composer, living through two tumultuous world wars, moving to the United States and France several times, and having to raise her daughter and eventually her granddaughter alone, Tailleferre faced constant criticism for her music's feminine attributes. In a review regarding Tailleferre's music in his popular 1927 survey of contemporary music, British writer Cecil Gray stated of Madame Germaine Tailleferre, "Sir, a woman's composing is like a dog walking on his hind legs. It is not done well, but you are surprised to find it done at all." Tailleferre never understood the feminine label. To her, music was music. Fellow Tailleferre scholar Laura Mitgang also provides a direct quote from Tailleferre, stating, "What difference does it make? The essential thing is that it be music. I do not see a reason why I shouldn't write what I feel. If it gives the impression of being feminine, that is fine. I was tormented by explanations. I tried to do the best I could, but I never asked myself if it was feminine or not. If it is music, it is music. I find that I place myself more among the little matters of the 17th and 18th centuries. I have always been attracted to simple things like that." Despite previously painful circumstances and many crude critics, Lacis continued supporting and promoting Tailleferre's musical ingenuity, although rarely gathering after Satie's death in 1925. Unknowingly, the one genre Tailleferre currently lacked compositional output in, wind band, would provide the key to Lacis's joint return during the late 20th century. Entering into her emergence into the world of wind band. Now, despite Tailleferre's non-existent wind band repertoire amongst her diverse musical portfolio, she was quite taken by wind band music, specifically Onager's March sur la Bastille, stating, "This march of Arthur's is great. When you hear it, it's like getting punched in the face." Before 1970, Tailleferre had written for winds in other significant compositions, including solo and chamber works. Yet she had not been presented with an opportunity to write exclusively for the modern wind ensemble. Paul Wehage, one of the scholars mentioned at the beginning of this presentation, stated, "If French military bands hadn't been such a male-dominated field, and somebody had thought to ask her, she would have written very good band music, and she clearly understood how to create that kind of texture in her orchestral works." So in late 1969, with Lacis's 50th anniversary quickly approaching, musicologist Frederick Robert proposed an anniversary concert at the Issy-les-Moulineaux Conservatory, collaborating with the director at the time, Desiree Dandin. Dandin and Robert decided the performance would solely celebrate Lacis's wind band compositions. However, they soon realized Tailleferre lacked representation within the wind band medium. Robert recalled their experience in the following statement. "We had to meet with Germaine because for each one of the members of the group Lacis, we had at least one work for a large or small band formation to work with, while she did not have in her catalog even a single work small enough for a wind band. So she showed us a partita pour flute, hautbois, clarinet, e-curd, dedicated to orchestra conductor Georges Zépine, who had not even presented the works as of yet. She offered to allow Dandin to transcribe it, and he did so in order to come up with three solos and a chamber band piece. With all Lacis members musically represented at the 50th anniversary concert held on February 14, 1970, Tailleferre's initiation into the wind band medium was complete through Dandin's transcription of her partita. Regarding this concert, Shapiro, one of the other scholars mentioned at the beginning of this presentation, told me, Tailleferre similarly throughout her life never found herself part of anything she deemed unsubstantial. She resonated strongly with the fullness of an extensive color palette wind instruments provided." Now, in her late 70s, wind band would become this new soundscape she fearlessly explored and painted her musical masterpieces upon. As Don Dan and Tailleferre continue their collaboration, transcribing earlier compositions and creating original band works, the collaborative process became even more necessary as Tailleferre's rheumatoid arthritis accelerated, causing her performance and writing abilities to deteriorate. She would sketch her manuscripts out on piano first and color code sections for Don Dan to then orchestrate for his wind ensemble with her input, leading to several original wind band compositions, including March for Harmony and Fanfare and Suite Divertimento. Tailleferre's first original wind band composition, March for Harmony and Fanfare, resulted from a recording project presented to Don Dan in 1976. Don Dan was commissioned to record an anthology of French military marches by the far-right nationalist politician Jean-Marie Le Pen, which spanned several volumes. Wehage believes Tailleferre did not take the commission seriously given her strong leftist views, but she respected Don Dan and ostensibly needed money the recording would provide her. Originally titled March Burlesque in her short piano score, then March Militaire, she finally settled on March for Harmony at Fanfare. Harmony, referring to a modern wind ensemble instrumentation, and Fanfare relating to brass instrumentation, not the musical style. The following instrumentation is listed before you as what would be seen in the transposed score. As evident, many of these types of instruments have several different keys they are played in or have the opportunity to be played in, and especially with percussion and some of the other wind parts, the language is in French. In regards to the formal structure of this piece, French marches, in general, are often emphasizing brass and percussion while adhering to a passe redoble form, which means returning on your steps. Typically in an ABA structure, the first A section introduces a fanfare with simple harmony, allowing for limited notes on valveless brass, as it would have been in the past. The central theme, often involving increased harmonic complexity and modulation, later returns to the introduction, adding a closing phrase. The B section, in contrast, presents greater lyricism above tonic and dominant harmonies. Now, Tailleferre's March for Harmony at Fanfare follows the passe redoble structure, but with several deviations. For example, the introductory brass and percussion fanfare is non-existent. Instead, her march immediately establishes the A theme with a stately C major melody in the upper woodwinds, cornet, and triangle. After a subtle transition, the A theme boisterously modulates to B major. Don Dan adds unique effects, including aggressive flutter tongue, rapid trills, and harmonic bitonality, tonicizing the relative minor key. Within the trio, three new melodies in E-flat major appear, not just one, adding more diversity to a typical march form. The first theme resembles a whistling tune carried in the euphonium and woodwinds, while a second melody with additional percussion reminisces more of a circus or carnival. Finally, the third lyrical melody appears above the first theme introduced in the B section. Following a short repeat within the trio, a variation of the original melodic content returns. Tailleferre begins this A prime section in canon with two instrumental ensembles, both in E-flat major, as a low woodwind and brass alternate chordal and C minor harmonies underneath. A brief transition therefore returns the ensemble to the beginning, repeating the original A material to the end. Now, Tailleferre's manuscript, which I had the ability to look at, provides a consistent blueprint regarding melodic and harmonic content compared with Don Dan's wind band orchestration from the beginning to measure 80 of this piece. However, the remaining 40 bars that are present in the wind band version are not existent in Tailleferre's original sketches. According to Paul Wehage, Tailleferre sourced many of her melodic fragments in the trio from the fourth movement of her ballet, La Nouvelle Cither, and other materials from her ballet, Parigiana. Robert Shapiro provides his thoughts regarding Tailleferre's compositional recycling in the following statement as well. He said, "I believe many scholars and musicians view Tailleferre's musical recycling as a weakness or laziness. However, I consider this method as innovative and a way to extract as much as she could through multiple orchestrations and mediums. She simply recycled previous material for her music to be heard, transformed, and inspired in various facets. Tailleferre's constant growth and exploration as a musician and composer provides strong evidence regarding her inventiveness through recycled musical materials. March for Harmony at Fanfare, lasting roughly 3.5 minutes, demonstrates Tailleferre's harmonic color palette, spanning triads to polytonality. Clever melodic manipulation and self-borrowing from her previous ballets are included throughout the work. Combined with Donden's skillful orchestration, the March for Harmony at Fanfare is a unique and innovative addition to the standard march genre, wind band genre, and a great piece to program if wanting to promote women composers and French music. Please enjoy Germaine Tailleferre's March for Harmony at Fanfare through this recording. Tailleferre's Suite Divertimento was composed the following year, 1977, with continued collaboration between herself and Donden. Commissioned by the French Ministry of Cultural Affairs and dedicated to the band Gardiens de la Paix de Paris, for which Donden conducted, Tailleferre wrote above the score, comme un bruit de foie, meaning like noise at a fair. Suite Divertimento, modeled after a 5-movement dance suite, is manipulated using classical forms and extended harmonies. Each movement embodies melodic clarity while promoting an homage to the past. Tailleferre utilized various compositional techniques throughout the suite of Rudimento by incorporating her Paris Conservatoire training into forms, melodies, and extended harmonies. As her compositional language expanded, Tailleferre drew from additional sources, including Impressionism, Neoclassicism, and yes, even Serialism. Overall, Tailleferre's compositional prowess and Dandin's orchestrational insight and wind band expertise created prolific and insightful contributions to the wind band medium. Here again is a list of the instrumentation shown in the score. Again, the wind parts often have different names and different keys in which they can be played in. Here's also the percussion parts, more evident in other languages, such as the pauken for timpani, or tambour de bosque, or klein trom for snare drum, and so forth. Now, there is no professional recording for this piece specifically, though the score is available. So hopefully in the future, there will be a professional recording of this work to continue to listen for. But the makeup of this piece is very unique and definitely worth diving into. So I'm going to provide a bit of feedback about each movement. Her first movement, the introduction, opens the suite of Rudimento in ternary form, or ABA, transporting listeners into more of a local fairground ruckus of the sights and sounds. Tailleferre features superimposed themes and contrasting tonalities between opposing instrumental groups throughout this introductory movement, creating a very chaotic texture. One example arises from measures 3 to 15, right at the beginning of the work, where the upper woodwinds demonstrate technical precision while executing constant 16th notes, tonicizing B-flat major. Concurrently, the trumpets are playing a fanfare centered on C minor, with cornets adding flutter tongue to invoke a more turbulent atmosphere. And all the while, underneath both thematic materials, the tenor saxophone and euphonium play a concert B natural, while first and second horn alternate between concert B flat and C natural every downbeat. Therefore, the euphonium and the tenor saxophone create this ongoing dissonance against the woodwind melody and horns during the opening material. Meanwhile, the alto saxophone and the third and fourth horn are adding a concert E flat and F natural eighth notes on offbeats. Now, Tailleferre also demonstrates extended harmonies interwoven throughout this first movement. A primary example resides between measures 62 and 69. In these four measures, there are four distinct instrumental groups divided into three additional sections presenting chordal sonorities or chords tonicizing the key of D flat major. Now, when each plays it alone, it sounds fairly tonal. However, polytonality is produced when the chords between all four groups are stacked into vertical alignment, creating a unique soundscape. As you can see here, I have laid out the different instruments for each section and what part they play. It's very, very unique, and if you have a chance to check this piece out, look at this section specifically. Now, the second movement, the barcarolle, transports listeners to more of a peaceful waterscape. This traditional folk song, which was sung by Venetian gondoliers, was frequently utilized by composers to elicit a gentle feeling of rocking in a duple compound meter, as if to imitate the motion of the gondolier. A lilting woodwind melody floats above muted brass and resonant vibraphone, with several harmonic shifts creating subtle waves throughout the movement until a solo clarinet appears, with swirling 16th notes guiding listeners safely back to shore. Tailleferre had written a barsuse for violin and piano in 1913 during her time at the Paris Conservatoire. Now, there's no direct musical quotation that exists between the previous work and Tailleferre's barcarolle from the suite of Rudimento. However, many common characteristics are present, including time signature, tempo markings, rhythmic groupings, chromatic alterations, and her overall aesthetic. By tonality, which for those that know what that means, basically encompasses two different chords or tonalities being played simultaneously, also appears throughout the music, creating an impressionistic atmosphere, specifically between the final chord of B flat minor and C minor on top of one another. With a more reduced instrumentation, this movement reflects a chamber ensemble. Those playing must maintain a tranquil ambiance through subtle rocking motions and melodies reminiscent of a lullaby. This also leaves a little bit up to the conductor, especially deciding if you're going to conduct in two or in six when the trombone is playing quarter notes, three quarter notes to a bar at the beginning, while others play eighth notes. Her third movement, the minuet, a form we had mentioned earlier in the presentation, reminisces a slow form of couples dance originating in France around the 17th century. This movement defies conventional expectations. As James Holm, a fellow Tailleferre researcher, states, as in much of her output, Tailleferre uses traditional forms but infuses them with her unique harmonic style. She frequently moves between unrelated key areas yet creates a sense of cohesion through her melodies. Tailleferre's minuet utilizes self-borrowing from her previous solo repertoire. Many similar musical elements such as key center, tempi, and rhythms are reflected in her minuet for oboe and piano from 1975. Tailleferre also includes musical fragments from her previous solo work, Galliard for trumpet and piano, written in 1973, echoed in the cornet, trumpet, and upper woodwinds throughout the A section of this movement. Both themes are identical, apart from Tailleferre beginning this melodic motif on beat 2 in the minuet, opposed to beat 1 in her original trumpet piece. Here is an example of that. The fourth movement of this five-movement work, titled Nocturne, originally was titled Serenade. This recalls the sentimental barcarolle from movement 2. However, listeners once more are exploring a peaceful soundscape after hearing a very chaotic and incessant theme throughout the minuet. A woodwind chamber ensemble establishes the ethereal mood during the prologue and epilogue, gently joined by other members of the ensemble. However, Tailleferre interrupts her subtle nocturne with an unexpected rondo allegro section in the middle. Tailleferre's source material stems from her serenade in La Mineure, composed between 1976 and 1977. Originally for two oboes, clarinet and B-flat, bassoon and piano. Here is part of the prologue from the saxophone quartet and piano arrangement of this work published by Paul B. Hedge. Tailleferre's Nocturne, as just heard through the saxophone version, is identical in melody, key, and harmony with different instrumentation. The entire movement remains in A minor. However, Tailleferre does not restrict herself to one key, but introduces polymodality and additional seventh and ninth chords throughout, leading to her final movement, titled Finale, evoking a cyclical nature with thematic material from the first movement reappearing in various instrumentation. Tailleferre's motivic development demonstrates her continual resourcefulness and creativity. Despite the consistency in meter and return of familiar material, the final punctuation to Tailleferre's Finale arrives rather abruptly, leaving listeners in disarray. I provided on this slide a few things to be aware of if you do decide to conduct this piece or play it, things to know about. The beginning with the saxophones, there are two. Ideally, there's no break in the sound, and hopefully if they have a chance to circular breathe, they can, but if not, there are ways to work around that. There are many chordal harmonies and key changes, A, D flat, F major, and one chord in the middle of the piece measures 70 to 72 with the ensemble spanning five octaves of E flat. On the bottom of the slide, you can see the trumpet part from her original manuscript written out as familiar material from the first movement. Now, wind band finally resided proudly upon Tailleferre's prolific compositional mantle. She was the last living member of Lacis, passing away at age 91 on November 7th, 1983. Spanning nearly 100 years, Tailleferre continually defied all limitations set against her as a woman and composer throughout the turbulent 20th century. She embodied a musical movement that shaped a nation, echoed throughout her vast musical innovations and experiences as a member of Lacis. Though her compositional mentors all played a vital role in promoting her musical career, the unique harmonies and timeless melodies she crafted remained hers alone. Both Tailleferre's March for Harmony at Fanfare and Suite Divertimento present a magnificent culmination of her extensive compositional career. Her extended harmonies, dulcet melodies, expansive forms, and innovative techniques are all represented within these wind band works. Both compositions include new material while also paying homage to her past creations. Musical merit exposed within these original compositions peer through a transcendent lens, bridging the gap between past and future. Performing Tailleferre's wind band works represents her musical personality, spirit, and compositional craft spanning nearly a century. Though she currently remains widely unknown and underrepresented, scholarly research surrounding Tailleferre's turbulent life, expansive musical catalog, and profound artistry is increasing, primarily due to the efforts of Paul Wehedge and Robert Shapiro, and now myself included. Tailleferre has left an undeniable musical legacy within the wind band medium, and for female composers everywhere. As an active member of Lacis, composer, and musician, Tailleferre truly represents a league of her own. I hope you've enjoyed this presentation. I want to just quickly go and provide the bibliography of the resources that I sought out. If you are interested in looking at any of these resources and finding out more, thank you very much.